Now reaching that helipad right now. He'll get on that helicopter, as we said, for the short 15-minute ride, accompanied by many members of the pontifical household, private secretaries, Archbishop Gonswine, also Monsignor Wareb, also his butler, and his personal physician. They will make the ride with him to what will be his home for the next several weeks, as his apartments inside the Vatican, a former cloister for nuns, will be prepared for his life as Pontiff Emeritus. A life, John Thavis, that he says will be devoted to study, prayer, and meditation.
And I think the church is happy to take him at his word at that. You know, there is no job description for a retired pope. And it's going to be Pope Benedict Emeritus who writes that job description. I think everyone in the church knows that here is a man of great discretion, a man who would never interfere with the work of his successor.
I want to interrupt you there, because I was speaking with Cardinal Dolan of New York this morning, and he said that he hopes the Pope continues to write. Is that realistic for a retired Pope to have published writings?
Well, it could pose a question, because obviously if he publishes, he may be saying some very interesting things. It's hard to imagine Pope Benedict not writing. It's hard to imagine him not thinking, not studying.
Cardinal Worrell, I see you wincing a little bit at the idea of published writings.
Well, I think he can write, but I wonder if when those become public is going to be the real issue.
Perhaps posthumously.
Yes.
You know, we have seen the final tweet now from the Pope. Of course, the Pope, the first Pope to have a Twitter account, he has now sent out his last tweet. It says, "Thank you for your love and support. May you always experience the joy that comes from putting Christ at the center of your lives." Terry Moran, the Pope speaking of the joys of his office yesterday as well, but also the troubles, and this has not been an easy.
Hasn't. It's been 8 years which has shaken the church and the faith of many Catholics and the opinion of the church in the eyes of many non-Catholics because of some of the scandals that have come out and the picture of the workings of the church. And through it all, he's had to bear those burdens and, as His Eminence says, keep preaching the gospel to a world which sometimes doesn't much want to hear it, certainly. So that's been a struggle for him, and he's been frank about how hard it has been.
And Koki, that sexual abuse crisis touched not only the United States, but really just about every country where the Catholic Church
And it has really shook the church to its foundations and the faithful to our foundations. It is something that is so dispiriting and wrong, in every way wrong, sinful. And the idea that first that these horrible abuses would happen and then that they would be covered up has really taken away the moral authority of many of the church spokesmen at a time when it's been needed in the world as a whole.
And Cardinal Worrell, as you and your fellow cardinals prepare to choose the next pope, how does the church face this scandal and overcome and restore itself?
I think there's one particular way in which we have to deal with this. We've already taken the steps to address it and to see that it doesn't happen again. But what we really have to do, and I think what Koki said is right on target, we have to begin to rebuild the confidence in the church. And the way we do that is to do what the church does best. Her ministry, preach the gospel, care for the poor, be there for people. In parishes, I think that's where confidence will be restored.
And as the Pope prepares to take off, we're hearing the bells over Rome right now. I want to go to David Wright, just outside St. Peter's Square. We see the bells right there. Tell us the scene there now.
Well, you've got a growing crowd gathered to watch this event on TV screens that are permanently posted in St. Peter's Square. As the bells ring, I'm reminded of the moment when Benedict stepped out on that balcony 8 years ago. None of us expected that we would be back here so soon. And I think as the end of this papacy approaches, you can see the church almost adapting its rituals, adapting what is normally reserved for just the death of a pope to this transition today. We're going to be seeing him every step of this way on his journey from St. Peter's to Castel Gandolfo. And the crowd here certainly seems to be eager to see him off.
All the bells of Rome now building to say farewell to Pope Benedict XVI as he prepares to leave Rome for the last time as Pope, taking off there from the Vatican on his way to Castel Gandolfo, where at 8 p.m. tonight Rome time, 2 p.m. Eastern time in the United States, his resignation will take effect. And Cokie, as Harry was saying just a minute ago, and the bells and that sign, grazie, suggest a real outpouring of affection in these final hours for the Pope.
Yes, absolutely. But coming at a time that is very, very difficult. And this is what Cardinal Wuerl and his colleagues are going to have to deal with as they go into conclave in not too long from now, we assume, Your Eminence. And, you know, one of the things that we see, for instance, is in the American church. Even though people are faithful to the religion, they are not necessarily agreeing.
And we see the helicopter over our shoulders right now as the Pope is taking off. And Cardinal Cokie does bring up this heavy responsibility you and your fellow cardinals share. You will meet on Monday to decide when the conclave begins, and then 115 of you, 117 are eligible, will begin the process of choosing the next Pope. Just tell everyone at home a little bit about how that process is going to begin and how you will conduct yourselves.
Well, as you point out, Monday morning we'll begin this pre-conclave session, and the purpose of that is twofold. The cardinals have to get to know each other better personally, since we're going to be picking one of them to be Pope. So that'll be part of this.
More than half of you will be voting. We're chosen by Pope Benedict, so you don't know each other that well.
That's true.
And you have never been in a conclave.
And that is one of the reasons why there's this period built in just to get to know one another. And then there are all the little details of preparing for the conclave itself. Also just reading the rules to all of us so we all get familiar with how this all works. But then comes the moment of the conclave itself. And when that moment is on us and we go into the Sistine Chapel and that's all closed, now comes the solemn function of choosing who will succeed this wonderful, beloved Pope who we see now flying away.
Speeding away. I should point out at this point that the Pope himself is a helicopter pilot. He's not flying this time. But he does enjoy flying. And talk about the qualities you believe you and your colleagues are looking for most at this moment. Yeah, they're circling over Rome, right over our left shoulder.
He's circling St. Peter's.
Yeah. Well, it provides him one last view of his city. One last view of the city of which he is still bishop for a couple more hours. And I think it gives everyone a chance to offer a prayer for him as he flies over, as he's doing right now.
Right over his head.